they changed the face of music.
One hit after the other.
I love the Bee Gees.
They're everlasting.
Raw flavor.
They're creative.
Genius.
I love it.
Totally magic.
I really like the Bee Gees.
The Bee Gees now are icons.
I know of no other creative family that's endured this long.
You can't deny talent. They never really stopped having hits.
And here they are, the Bee Gees.
We often thought we were triplets at one time because we all had the ultimate goal of just singing together.
I feel that what we've been doing all our lives has been our destiny.
It's really about three brothers that always said they were going to be famous.
The story of the brothers Gibb is a roller coaster ride of triumph and tragedy, setbacks and comebacks. And during a career that has spanned more than 40 years, they've repeatedly shown a unique ability to reinvent their sound and reconnect with audiences around the world. Their remarkable journey begins in 1944 in Manchester, England, with the marriage of drummer and bandleader Hugh Gibb to Barbara Pass. The next year, the Gibbs welcomed a baby girl, Leslie, and settled off the coast of Great Britain on the Isle of Man. On September 1, 1946, Barry, the first Bee Gee, was born. He barely survived his childhood.
I was very badly scalded when I was about 2 years old.
He climbed on a chair and pulled a tablecloth towards him, and I just made a big pot of tea, pulled it all over himself. And he was in hospital for 3 months. He was very, very ill.
My mother tells me that it was about 2 years before I was back to normal again. Those 2 years, I don't remember. So whatever happened to me was blanked out completely.
He never spoke till he was 3 years old because of all the pain he'd gone through, you know.
And I think that when those things happen to you in life, what you gain from it is incredible inner strength.
It did make him stronger, more determined. I think that's what really helped us, you know, to make the pattern for his life.
The Gibb family welcomed two more sons on December 22, 1949, when twins Robin and Morris were born. They were neither identical in appearance nor disposition.
They've always had distinctive personalities. Morris was always very friendly, everybody's mate. Robin's always been a little bit withdrawn and into himself, but when they were together, they were the same.
I was Mr. Goody Goody. I was so scared of doing anything wrong.
I'm basically a very shy person. I have to really know somebody before I reveal myself, literally.
Robin was a joyous kid. He was hysterically funny. You'd always be in stitches, you'd always be laughing. This was the funniest kid you could ever meet.
I like being spontaneous, I like being funny with people, I like being relaxed, but you won't get that right away with me, you see.
Robin always had the twinkle in his eye. And of course I think Morris did too, don't forget they're twins, you know, so there was a specific way that they would play off each other that only twins would know.
When you're identical twins, a lot of people will wear the same clothes, even later on in life, in the teenage years. Robin and I differ in the fact that we're fraternal twins and we're not identical, but we have the same sense of humor. We have the same love of the same kind of music.
Being a twin, I don't think it's so much having much to do with the Bee Gees. I think we would have been the Bee Gees if we hadn't been twins. I never thought of me and Morris as separate from Barry. I always saw the three of us as three equal brothers.
By 1955, Hugh's band had broken up. So, in search of new opportunities, he moved the family back to Manchester. In the glory days of the empire, Manchester was the world's cotton capital, one of the great industrial centers. Now, it was a working class city in decline. So too were the Gibb family fortunes. To support Barbara and the four kids, Hugh held down two jobs. The house was always filled with music. The boys were influenced by the Mills brothers and the Everly brothers. And by the time Barry was nine and the twins were six, they were already singing in three-part harmony.
there was quite a number of times when my parents and my sister would come in the room and wonder if the radio was on when we were doing that early stuff.
Lollipop is one of the songs we used to sing, remember?
At the age of seven, I remember very clearly seeing on television Song and Dance Man, and I remember it hitting me in the head that that's what I'd like to do. And I would just pretend to do that. And it was, I'm looking over a four-leaf clover. So I would do all this stuff, and I'd pretend to be the Song and Dance Man.
The real love of it is when I heard Wake Up Little Susie by the Everly Brothers. And I kept on playing it over and over again. And I kept on hearing these harmonies.
Robin and I seem to have evolved into two different leads, and Morris is an expert harmonist, is that the right word? But he would always know where to put that other melody, make a three-part harmony.
I think it was about a year after we first started it, having fun, that we realized it was what we wanted to do for the rest of our lives. But we weren't sitting down making plans, we were just kids having fun.
The Bee Gees' musical career actually began at the movies. One day before the feature, a boy got up on stage and mimed to an Elvis Presley record. The brothers were inspired to try it themselves.
We went to see the cinema manager and asked if we could get up one Saturday afternoon and do just what that boy had done, you know? And he said, okay. He said, I can't pay you anything. We said, you get paid? So we got the guitar and the records that we intended to mime to. And on the way to the Gaumont Theatre, we were running and Morris dropped the records. In those days, they broke, folks.
We were very disappointed that we'd lost our chance, but we persuaded the manager to allow us to go on and sing anyway.
And we just did what we did at home. And the kids loved it, and I remember that feeling. It was great.
And we had our first real audience rush, you know? Wow, this is what we want to do.
We'd sit up all night talking about what we wanted to do in the future when we grow up. And we were talking about all the things we wanted to do. We wanted to make records, we wanted to write, and we didn't know where we were going. We used to sort of daydream and nightdream and every other kind of dream, and we just talk about it day and night.
Walking down the street in Manchester, I remember Barry saying that one day we're going to be really famous. And we said, oh yeah, yeah. Whatever you say, he's the big brother, you know.
It was like a pact that we made in Manchester, that this is where we were going and nowhere else. That we were not going to detract from this path. We were going to be famous come hell or high water. And after the hell and the high water.
As pint-sized rock and rollers, Barry, Robin, and Morris performed frequently at local theaters. To adults in the 1950s, rock and roll was synonymous with trouble. And so were the brothers Gibb.
Barry and Robin, they were terrorists. I mean, nothing stopped in their way.
Now when I think back, I feel really bad for my parents. Because if I had been my parents, I would have been pulling my hair out, you know. And my father had little enough as it was.
Robin especially was very naughty. He used to light fires all over the place.
Oh, yeah. You mean the flame?
He used to set hedges on fire. He'd light fires under the bed.
Yeah, I was a bit of a firebug when I was young.
We lit a little fire in the field next to the house and it spread. And it must have been in the middle of summer, but it spread all over the place.
I went to look for them because it was getting, you know, bedtime. And I walked through the town and I saw all these fire engines. And I thought, oh no, I knew it was behind it. And they did all the lot of damage.
So we got to the top of the hill and there were all the billboards burning. And it was a fantastic sight. And there was a policeman standing right next to us, and we had our swimming costumes and our towels underneath our arms, you know. And we looked at the policeman, and he looked at us, and what happened, you know? And he said, you know, don't worry, we'll catch him. We'll catch him. And we sort of stood there. Yes, we hope you do, officer, yes. And but that was the end of it.
The police did come one day and said, look, it's a reform school, but they said it could end up to a point where you would have to go to court. And and be charged and be sent to a reform school if it got out of hand.
I think actually it was the Manchester police that sort of encouraged my mother and father to go to Australia, take them.
And he said, you know, maybe it's time you thought about emigrating, because maybe these kids, they need more, they need space.
So, in 1958, with newborn baby Andy in tow, Hugh and Barbara decided the family needed to make a fresh start.
I'd never heard of Australia. It's just a strange word to me, Australia. I'm sort of Australia.
When you're 8 years old, 7 or 8 years old, it's an adventure. This is like, wow, I imagine like kangaroos going down the streets of Sydney and all these sort of adventurous places that we're going to go to, exotic, different, you know.
Oh, amazing, adventure. Because that was what was in our spirit. That's why we were always getting into mischief. The idea of what's around the corner really was inside us. So the idea of going to Australia, we didn't even know what that was. But sounds good. Let's try it.
The Gibbs settled in Queensland, a state in northeast Australia known for its sunshine, beautiful beaches, and the Great Barrier Reef. Hugh took a job as a photographer. He bought an 8mm camera, and the brothers immediately began making home movies.
I was filming them. I was always the guy behind the camera, because I've always been the technical one. Barry and Robin, I wouldn't go as far as to say that their videotape players are still flashing 12, but it's...
He's gadget man, yeah. Whatever's new, Morris has bought yesterday. You know, it's that type of gadget freak, you know. But you could see it in those days. His fascination with cameras, his fascination with 8mm filming. So in our very early home movies, the reason you see so much of Robin and me is because Morris is doing the filming.
We'd film home movies of fights and things and people like hostage taking, or, you know, people blowing up the tower, you know. We used to just come up with some daft stuff.
The humour that we have is a very British sense of humour. And it's really been and always has been strongly influenced by Peter Sellers, Spike Milligan and Harry Secombe. They made up The Goons, which was a BBC radio show when we were growing up.
And it was totally left field. They would come out with lines like, right, men, are you ready? We leave at dawn tonight. You know, and it'd be very quick and very, very sort of weird sort of sense of humour. It was a very dry English sense of humour. And we got into that big time. We loved it.
No, it's always been there, and they always make you laugh. They bounce off one another. Just little things that can make sound hilarious.
In Australia, the brothers continued their quest for fame. To achieve that goal, they would sing just about anywhere.
We always looked for the best toilets in town.
So we've worked in some of the best toilets, let me tell you.
We'd go and sing in there because of the echo. And there's a great one I remember in Pitt Street, Sydney. No, it was in the park, and it was a great echo, really long, and it was, we sang these harmonies, they sounded like records.
The brothers took their act to a local speedway, where they sang between races. The crowd showed their appreciation by throwing coins. Bill Gates, a local disc jockey, was impressed, and persuaded Hugh and Barbara to let him promote the boys. As the initials BG were everywhere, Bill Gates, Barbara Gibb, Barry Gibb, Brothers Gibb, it was suggested that the trio be called the Bee Gees. Soon, the boys were heard regularly on Gates' radio show. In the summer of 1960, the Bee Gees got their next big break.
The Bee Gees, Barry A., the leader of the group, come here. Barry Gibb and your young brothers. Now, come on, who are you? Which is which? You're twins, eh?
I'm Robin.
Robin?
Morris.
And Morris. Now, you all sing together, eh?
That's right.
And your brother Barry plays. Now come on up. Come on up here.
This was the first of what would be many TV appearances over the next few years.
I'll swing long and sing long, this time is passing by. I'll drift long and breathe long, this life a butterfly. Cause as long as I'm living, I'll always be giving you my love.
The Bee Gees played county fairs and clubs where they honed their craft as performers. With the act still in its formative stages, show business veteran Hugh became their manager.
My father, bless him, has been unbelievable in our lives. He has been the main instigator of everything that we learnt about stage.
Oh, my old man's a dustman, he wears a dustman's hat. He wears God blimey shrouders, and he lives in a council flat.
Even down to little things like when you go on, smile, because if you look like crap and you feel like crap, so will the audience. Smile, they'll smile with you. He taught us professionalism.
I said, now hang on, Dad, you're getting past your prime.
And I was doing the clothes, we used to make all the little waistcoats, and we cut an old pair of evening shoes up to make BG and gold leather on the little things, you know.
Every time I think of Mum, I just vision her behind the ironing board, ironing the shirts.
I've washed and ironed 42 shirts when they were going on tour. Barry wouldn't let me send anything to the laundry. I used to wash them, and I didn't have a washing machine. Did them all by hand, and then ironed all these shirts. So I worked hard.
Now if you see a dustman all looking all pale and sad, don't kick him in the dustbin, it might be my old dad.
When we first started doing professional stuff, we were kind of like a child act doing the clubs in and around Sydney.
You ever see that one at the beginning of Crocodile Dundee? That we work places like that. So to give you an idea, it was very rough.
Working men's clubs and leagues clubs and stuff, where they had slot machines and stuff, you had to have a kind of act that would be entertaining to them.
But we always had to put humour into the act, you know. For years, actually, Robin was the comedian in the club act, and I was the straight man, and Barry was the older brother. It was like a mixture of the Smothers Brothers, I guess, a little bit of both. But we did that because the mums and dads loved it. That's what you worked in front of. We didn't work in front of teenagers until we were teenagers.
So Morris would have a tie that would go up, you know, and sort of a tie with an erection, if you will. Or if you won't, you know. He would do that during the show, and he would do it in the middle of a song, and it'd be fantastic, you know, because you'd be singing a dramatic song and the tie would suddenly start to come up, you know. And I think the audience loved that stuff, you know, because it's the last thing they expect in the world. So unexpected humour is the best.
In 1963, their dream of becoming stars took a giant leap forward. They signed a record contract. What made the Bee Gees unique at this young age was that they weren't just singers. They also wrote songs, and their very first release was a Barry Gibb original.
Kiss me once, oh yeah, baby. Kiss me twice, oh yeah, crazy. Kiss me three times, the three kisses of love, oh yeah. Morning, noon.
We released quite a few of our own songs and couldn't get a hit. We tried singing a couple of other people's songs, and we still didn't get a hit. So we thought, well, we'll just go back to singing our own songs because, you know, if we have flops, at least there are flops.
Tell me that you really care. I run your fingers through my hair. Kiss me once, kiss me twice, and I'm in paradise. Kiss me once, oh yeah.
We'd look at each other and say, we've just made that other step that we prayed that we might be able to do, you know? We've just done our first television show, we've just made our first record. We still haven't had our first hit, but we've made those steps. We were on our way somewhere, you know? We were always on our way somewhere.
At this point, the brothers were supporting the family as professional entertainers, singing adult songs to adults. But their music and their ambitions were instantly transformed in 1964 when Australia, like the rest of the world, was invaded by the British.
When the Beatles came to Sydney, the magic was unbelievable. I was mesmerized by them because they were doing something that we loved to do, and they were successful at it.
I loved it because it was so... This was a group, and they were singing three-part harmony. And they were singing it like we did.
The Bee Gees finally began denting the local charts in 1965 with self-penned songs like Wine and Women.
Wine and Women, song will only make me sad. Love and kisses and hearts, a thing I never had.
We put out a record called Wine and Women, which was literally our first top 20 record. And we gave $200 to some childhood friends, couple of young girls, and we told them, you know, go into Sydney and buy as many of Wine and Women as you can buy. And the next week we were number 19 on the charts. So, oh, this is how it works, you know. We've been buying our own records ever since, you know. We were doing television shows, but we were just regular TV acts. We weren't people having hit records, you know. And that was our dream. And at that point in time, our dream was being blocked.
I was totally convinced that the right thing we had for us to do was to leave Australia.
We knew if we were going to make it big international, we had to leave Australia
and go to London.
Righto, chaps, let's have a check. Blacks?
Check.
Check.
Righto, right, right. RPM, Morris.
Okay.
Right. Just before leaving the country, the Bee Gees recorded one last song, Spicks and Specks.
Where is the sun that shone on my head? The sun in my life, it is dead.
We're going back to England. We're going to break through in England. And that was a far bigger battle than we could have imagined.
Oh, where are the girls and left far behind?
We just had blind faith.
The Spicks and the Specks.
There was a feeling inside us that once people had heard us and knew what we were about, they'd like us.
So they wanted to go home. So they couldn't really remember a lot about England, but they wanted to go back. We didn't want to go. We never wanted to go back. But we had to go. So my husband sent tapes to Brian Epstein. He sent tapes to Harry Lewis and Herbert Wilcox, people, London management, all these people, and left it at that.
Oh, where are the girls?
In January 1967, the entire Gibb family boarded a ship that would take them back home to England. While at sea, they received unexpected news.
Well, we were on the Indian Ocean when we heard Spicks and Specks had gone to number one, which was very exciting.
Just blew us away. And we're a week out now, you know. And we're thinking, oh, great. You know, the only people who knew were the rest of the Australians on board the ship, you know, going, hey, great, nice one, you got a number one.
So, of course, then they landed in England with a number one record in Australia. Didn't mean a thing.
5 weeks later, when the Bee Gees arrived in England, the music scene was still dominated by the Beatles, in whose wake had come the Rolling Stones, The Who, and many other successful groups. The Bee Gees were determined to be the next big thing. But their optimism was immediately challenged by a random encounter with another group.
There were these four guys standing on the dock. It was nighttime and it was thick fog. And these four guys were dressed exactly as the Beatles were dressed in Help.
They said they were a group, a failed group, and said, groups are out, it's over.
And they said, you know, go back. And we'd go back, where? It took us 5 weeks to get here, you know. Once again, it's like the resilience thing. It didn't matter what came our way. It was just another obstacle. Get out of the way. We're going to make it. We're going to be famous.
Before leaving Australia, the Bee Gees had mailed demo tapes to prospective record companies, agents, and managers in London. Nobody was interested, except for Robert Stigwood, who at the time was partnered with the Beatles manager, Brian Epstein. Stigwood liked what he heard and summoned them to an audition.
My gut instinct told me that they would be sensational because you can't deny talent. And the talent was so obvious.
We go to the Savile Theatre in London, and downstairs there's a, like a lounge room and bar and stuff that they have in the theatres, and we set up down there.
Robert came in his coat, looking a bit like Oscar Wilde. You know?
I've always felt to this day he was a little the worse for wear when he came down, but I'm being kind, Robert.
They claim I fell asleep, which is rubbish.
He came in with his assistants and sat down. Said, okay, you know, sing, show me what you do.
And we did our club act from even a Peter, Paul and Mary section we do.
We didn't know how, you know, we were getting across to him. And then he was singing that we did about four or five songs. And he had two people next to him, and then he got up and he nodded to them and they all walked out. And that was it.
They came home and they were really heartbroken. They said it was just a waste of time. They got home about 5 o'clock in the afternoon. At 8:30, the phone rang and it was Robert. He said, bring them in tomorrow to sign the contracts. Just as quick as that, you know, and they didn't think he'd even heard them.
Stigwood had heard them and immediately signed the brothers to a 5-year contract.
The link between Bob Stigwood and the Bee Gees was very close, and the relationship was just like that of Brian Epstein and the Beatles. For Bob Stigwood, the Bee Gees were his boys, and it was like a family almost.
And the thing is, Robert loved them and he believed in them. Sometimes a bit of a complex relationship, but it certainly worked.
He opened up the world to the Bee Gees very, very quickly, and I don't think at that particular time anyone else could have done that job. And what's happening to us today is because of what he did then.
Robert Stigwood sat there and said, you're going to do it, and I'm going to make sure you do it. And he never, ever made a negative comment about whether it might or might not work. This is where we're going, and that's it.
In the event of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see.
I was preparing to make their first album. I took them into a demo studio.
And he said, "Can you, while you're here," it was one of the last nights, he says, "would you just write one more song for me that you really believe in?" You know. And in those days, we used to write a song in 15 minutes. You know, they weren't necessarily good, but we wrote really fast. And we went out and sat on the steps because we had to get away from everybody else to do it.
There was a power breakdown. So the three lads sat on the stairs in the dark.
In the area where the cage is, where the elevator goes down and there's steps on either side, we just sat on the steps and Barry was playing his guitar.
We were in pitch darkness. And so we were sitting, and the echo was fantastic, better than any of those toilets. And you had the whole echo of the elevator shaft and everything, so it sounded great.
I keep straining my ears to hear a sound.
And the vision that came to us was the idea of being in a mine with no light, and how would that feel?
Or have they given up and all gone home to bed, thinking those who once existed must be dead? Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you now? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
To augment their sound and make themselves into a real band, the Bee Gees added two musician friends from Australia, Colin Peterson on drums and Vince Maloney on lead guitar. The new group recorded their first single, and Stigwood mounted a bold publicity campaign, declaring them the most significant new musical talent of 1967.
Whoa. Talking about us? You know, we were like, whoa, and Barry goes, oh my God, that's something to live up to.
This is how Stigwood wanted to launch the Bee Gees. And he didn't want to do it half-heartedly. He knew that he wanted to make an impact. And the only way about doing it is actually throwing down the gauntlet.
And they were compared with the Beatles right from the word go, which really was a compliment.
Definitely the pressure we needed to inspire us. A lot of people would be overwhelmed by this kind of thing, but with us, that's what we wanted.
When New York mining disaster appeared in the spring of 1967, it really cut through almost everything else on the radio, like just a beacon through a fog, because it was a strong narrative, mood-building song.
Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones?
Made people realize that there were some really good new storytellers in popular music.
Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
In less than 6 months, the Bee Gees had gone from unknowns at the Southampton docks to having top 20 hits on both sides of the Atlantic. They were instantly plunged into the hurricane of first fame.
But at that point, just as our heads were about to explode, you know, Robert sat us down and said, now I want you to listen to me. You haven't made it. You've got a hit record. Don't get it all out of proportion. When you've had 5 hit records, I'll say to you, you've made it.
A key element of their success was the emotional depth of their sound. The Bee Gees had always been fans of soul music. Recognizing this, Stigwood arranged a meeting with a legendary soul artist.
He introduced me to Otis Redding, and we sat in the suite, and we chatted for a while, and Robert said, I want you to write a song for Otis Redding. And I said, well, we'll certainly try, you know, we'd be delighted, because we were huge fans. Robert went out that night, and he said, I'm leaving you alone tonight. When I come back, I want to hear an Otis Redding song. Oh, thanks, Robert, you know. But what does it bring? I was young enough and ambitious enough that, of course, I'll do it right away, you know. To love somebody was born that night. You don't know what it's like. Baby, you don't know what it's like. To love somebody, to love somebody, the way I love you. So I sang the body of that song to Robert when he came in. He said, thank you, that's what I want. And when I got back to England, we finished the song together.
Redding died before he could record To Love Somebody. So the brothers cut it themselves, turning it into one of their most beloved songs.
To love somebody the way I love you.
Just before moving to England, Barry had married his Australian sweetheart, Maureen. But pop stardom changed everything, and they quickly drifted apart.
I was one of those people who couldn't wait to get married. And that was me. I had to be loved, or I had to have a companion. We were in the studio morning, noon, and night. We were promoting Full Belt before we had a hit record. And so I hardly saw Maureen, and she hardly saw me. So within a year, the whole thing just fell apart, you know.
For Morris, those early heady days were one long holiday. He quickly fell into the swinging London scene, and before long, he was welcomed into the most exclusive circles of rock royalty.
When you think that 5 months before all this was going on, I was in Pitt Street buying up the Beatle fan club book. And now here I am partying with these guys, my heroes. So the drink came more, the money became more. I'm only 18, 19 years of age. You know, and after all the work we had done through clubs and everything, I felt grown up. I felt like I'd been through the mill. I just gotta get a
message to you. Robin began dating Molly Hullis, the receptionist in Stigwood's office. They would be married in late 1968. But not before Robin faced the most traumatic event of his life.
Hither Green, less than 24 hours after the horror of the Caravelle crash.
On November 5th, Robin and his girlfriend Molly were returning to London by train. Suddenly, the train came off the tracks. 49 people were killed, 78 seriously injured.
There were just 2 of us in the compartment, and we ended up upside down, hearing people screaming. I got out of the window, walked along the side, and saw bodies everywhere.
We were waiting for Robin to join us, and I stood up in the room, and I said, I think something's happened to Robin.
Pull people out of the wreckage. Yeah, I mean, it was amazing that when you're in a situation like that, you don't know your own strength. And I was bruised afterwards a lot from lifting people up. They were twice my weight.
We found out where they were, where all the people were taken, at Hither Green Hospital, and we drove straight there.
And there amongst it all was poor little Robin and Molly sort of sitting in a corner like this, you know.
The hospital scene was absolutely horrifying, seeing those people with the kind of injuries that they had. It was literally like being in World War II.
I think that it probably took things like the train disaster to bring out the pathos in Robin. It's been there ever since.
feel I'm going back to Massachusetts. Something's telling me I must go home.
I think once Massachusetts became a number one record in England, our first number one record, and that was something.
Out in Massachusetts, the day I left, a standing on her own.
You can actually guess how you're going to feel when you get your first number one, because it's something you've always wanted to have. It was kind of like a fulfillment of what we wanted to do. We left Australia. It was kind of a confirmation of our belief in ourselves. It's kind of like, yeah, we did the right thing.
It was their first international number one. I think for any artist and their management, when you crack that, it's a very special and emotional moment.
I still think, I still choke when I think about it.
What I was so impressed with in terms of the Bee Gees is that the harmonies were incredible. Very, very unique, very distinctive. Almost to where the name Bee Gees was the adjective for what they were doing from the minute they appeared on American radio. It's like it sounds like the Bee Gees.
I don't know anybody who can sing harmony quite so naturally as they do. You know, get them in a room here and ask them to sing, and immediately you're assailed by perfect harmony.
The Bee Gees' singular sound also features the presence of two distinct lead vocal styles: Barry's soulful, passionate delivery and Robin's ethereal vibrato.
I started a joke which started the whole world crying.
He's got a wonderful voice. It still makes me go cold when I listen to him.
I don't think there was any particular plan about who sang what. It's just where things fell, you know, where certain songs and styles worked at a certain frame of time. But certainly it was based on the style of the song more than who sang it.
Who sang the leads has never been an issue. Robin's voice was so infectious at that point that it just, those were the songs that he automatically should be singing. I knew, you know, and Morris knew that that vibrato was killer, you know, and the more we could use it, the better.
It was a vulnerable instrument in a very forceful way. It could communicate a vulnerability but a lot of personal intensity at the same time. Because he had no competition whatsoever in pop music, there was no other voice like his. What could have seemed like a weakness became an incredible strength in the band.
When it comes to the songs like Joke and Holiday, I mean, who do you, you know, I mean, that's the voice. That's the voice that reaches your heart.
Oh, if I'd only see that the joke was on me.
An undeniable strength of the Bee Gees has always been their songwriting. Like John Lennon and Paul McCartney, the brothers, sometimes working separately, sometimes together, were quickly proving to be prolific composers.
Every time they would write something, they would play it to me, that I would analyze very carefully with them. And there were no holes barred at all, just an open debate, which I would normally win.
I think there's an affinity between the Bee Gees and the Beatles, particularly with their early material, in the linking of very good hooks, very good melodies, which stick in the mind. And that, in itself, is an extraordinarily difficult thing to do.
You had to listen to these songs once they came on. You had to listen to them because they were very, very magnetic. And they cast a spell in a way that was very piercing in its personal directness.
Smile, an everlasting smile. A smile can bring you near to me. Go ever let me find you gone, 'cause that would bring a tear to me.
Barry had emerged as the sex symbol of the group. He was as irresistible to women as they were to him.
I would always carry rings in my pocket so that I'd be able to say to that girl, I love you, here's the ring, you know? And it always led to bed. And I was a rogue. Yes, I was a rogue, I admit it.
But once I saw Linda, there was only one ring.
I met Linda at Top of the Pops. Linda was chosen to be the hostess the week that we were on and the week that Massachusetts was number one. And I saw her across the studio with a sash, I think it said Miss Edinburgh. And I remember thinking, that girl is devastating. And I'm going to be my usual self. I'm going straight over to that girl and do something about it.
Shortly after meeting Linda, Barry and Robert Stigwood traveled to California on business. But business wasn't on Barry's mind. Right after checking into the Beverly Hills Hotel, Barry told Stigwood that he was going home.
And he said, what? You can't go back to England, we've just arrived. There's things you have to do, there's a whole schedule. And I said, but you don't understand. Or maybe you do understand, Robert, that this is the girl, this is the one, you know? I've got to go back, I've got to find her. I can vouch for the fact that love at first sight happens, and most certainly happened to me.
Ooh, you're a holiday.
Barry wasn't the only Bee Gee falling in love. On December 12, 1968, with clamoring press and fans on hand, Robin and Molly married.
Beep, 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 beep,
a few months later, on February 17, 1969, in what was the pop wedding of the moment, Morris tied the knot with Lulu, one of England's brightest young stars. The Bee Gees' greatest strength had always been their unbreakable family bond. While on the surface everything seemed wonderful, the truth was that success, love, and the trappings of fame were ripping the Bee Gees apart.
I mean, there was a lot of money all of a sudden, and cars, and girlfriends, and, you know, things like that.
Your world was upside down. You just went wherever you were supposed to go, and people knew you, and people said hello and shook your hand, and you had no idea why, except that we'd made it, whatever that is, you know.
So our relationship with each other changed a bit, because we were not just kids living together, we'd been kids living together with each other right up until the time we arrived, and even after we arrived in England. Now we were becoming men. And we were having thoughts about what men do on their own rather than as a unit.
It's very difficult being successful in the rock and roll business. It's damn sight more difficult to stay successful because the pressures are so great. You're always on demand, you're always at everyone's beck and call. You cannot escape the fame, which is a kind of prison for young people.
We needed that capacity for separate lives, where not everything was based on what the other did.
The tendency always is to say, damn it, I'm a Bee Gee, I'd much rather be Barry, or I'd much rather be Robin, or much rather be Morris. Same with the Beatles, you know. They got sick and tired of being a Beatle. They wanted to be their own people, with their own recognition.
As you sort of start to hit the edge of fame, then a sort of entourage emerges for each one, all giving advice, talking to them.
When you're that young and you're having a lot too much too soon, you tend to sort of, you like to have praise, and praise is a wonderful thing when you're a teenager. It kind of makes you feel and do things, it kind of makes you feel superhuman, you know.
Love interests were happening and jealousies were happening. You know, I call it just lack of maturity.
To me, a lot of what happened in that breakup was due to too much happening too soon.
What happened was drugs.
Pilly, potty and pissy, you know, each one did different drugs or whatever, you know. Robin would take a few pills if I smoked a joint or if I had a drink. Mine was booze, all the way.
We stopped knowing each other. We stopped feeling each other's feelings. And that's another lesson, you know. That's what drugs do. That's what drink does.
We lost contact with each other. Me, Barry, and Morris didn't really talk as much as we used to, and therefore, you know, there was a kind of bickering going on.
If Robin said something about me, the same reporter would come to me and say, did you know that Robin said that, and vice versa, you know. I don't think we were mature enough to stop it. I think we enjoyed publicity. So the press would thrive on it, and we thrived on it. So there was all these awful feelings. Conflict all round. But at least it's true, you know? At least no one else can say, oh, this is what happened. I'm telling you what happened, you know? It was all three of us became isolated. And all three of us did things to each other that I think we're all sorry for. So, you know, that's the truth of the matter.
Family groups have a really hard time, as a rule. And in 1969, when the Bee Gees broke up, it was really a family circumstance that had done it.
I think we were all as bad as each other. I don't think you can blame it on one person. I think we were all very selfish at that point.
There's always been two very forceful personalities in the Bee Gees, and that's Barry Gibb and Robin.
Poor old Morris was in the middle. He didn't know what was going on.
Yes, it's the story of my life, really.
Morris found himself on both sides of the escalating battle, torn between the conflicting ambitions of Barry and Robin. And Robin, believing Stigwood was giving Barry more attention, became resentful. With the group about to release their fourth album, the atmosphere surrounding the brothers had become charged with suspicion and distrust.
What really happened is 1st of May, the record was coming out, and everybody sort of went for 1st of May as being the A side, and Barry was singing the lead on that. And on the other side, there was Lamplight, which Robin wanted to sing in the lead. And so Robert chose 1st of May, and thinking he was biased towards Barry, Robin said, ah, that's it, I've had it, because he thought it was done on purpose.
A lot of things had gone down at that time, and we needed time apart to think about them.
And that was one of those moments that we had to realize we've got to be apart for a while. But not that we wanted to, but it just had to be.
Robin quit the group and started work on a solo album. He and Molly became isolated from the family. Disturbed by his erratic behavior, Hugh and Barbara tried to make 19-year-old Robin a ward of the court.
It was kind of a whole strange episode of our lives, that particular. It didn't make sense to me, it doesn't make sense now, but it happened. And it was kind of a weird feeling all the time it was happening.
Robin's very first solo single, Saved by the Bell, rose to number 2 on the British charts. Barry and Morris, continuing as the Bee Gees, made Don't Forget to Remember, which also went to number 2. Amidst all the turmoil, the two remaining Bee Gees filmed a comedy special for television.
Yes, pure silliness. I think it was good that we did Cucumber Castle. It doesn't mean I think that Cucumber Castle was good.
My cucumber and I welcome you to Cucumber Castle.
I just think it was good that we did something really silly.
A toast for my boring brother, the king.
And something that was fun.
Well, hello, letters.
Hi, who are we having for dinner?
You.
Anything to escape that whole era of drugs and to grow up finally, you know. Although from watching Cucumber Castle, I don't think we grew up at that very point.
In the event of something happening to me.
That was to come.
By early 1970, the Bee Gees had stopped working together and embarked on a series of solo projects.
I would never have guessed at that point, however, that the Bee Gees would come back together again. It didn't feel like that was ever going to happen.
I knew they would get back together eventually. I mean, blood's thicker than water. They were brothers.
The time we spent apart was basically a rough time for the three of us emotionally, because although we separated as a group, I don't think we really mentally wanted to.
We miss each other so desperately musically and as brothers, you know, we're brothers. And it couldn't go on. Even if we weren't a group anymore, we couldn't go on not speaking to each other all our lives.
After months of trying to figure out the best way to breach the gulf between them, the brothers were finally ready to come together as the Bee Gees.
When the three of them made the piece, I said, let's go into the studio right away.
It was a little nervous working together again. the first things we cut was How Can You Mend a Broken Heart, which was written in the afternoon, and Lonely Days that night, and two number one records, which we had no idea there would be.
Lonely days.
Lonely Days was an instrumental. I was playing the opening thing on the piano, and Barry and Robin came around and we started singing it, and before we knew it, the song was taking shape. We were like new, it was like fresh. It was the energy that each one had on expressing what they'd learned by being apart. It all came out in that week. And it was brilliant. It was a wonderful session, wonderful.
We came back as men, you see. We'd always been boys growing up together. Brothers before, and I think we came back together as three guys where we respected each other's space and interests and opinions. If anything, that was the good thing that came out of it.
It took 2-3 years to heal. There was a real serious estrangement there because it's hard to grow up under any circumstances and to admit the fact that you're never going to be distant from your family, that you need your family. You know, all of us have to leave home at some point. And the Bee Gees, in a way, found they couldn't leave home. They had to find some adult way of going back and making peace with the past.
In writing about the problems they faced as brothers, they had created music that was deeply felt.
I can think of younger days when living for my life was everything a man could want to do.
Singing about separation and reconciliation, about love lost and found, in essence, telling their own story, they reconnected with their audience.
I don't think people expected them to come back, either to reform or to come back with music that was so confident.
In the 1970s, the Bee Gees enjoyed a short burst of success.
Someone has hurt you and torn you apart. Am I unwise to open up your eyes to love me? And let it be like they said it could be. Me loving you, girl, and you. Am I unwise to open up your eyes to love? Come to me whenever you're lonely. To love, come to me if you need a shoulder. Now and then you need someone older. So darling, you run to me.
Run to Me was their fourth top 20 hit since they reunited.
After Run to Me, we went into a valley, totally. Our career was in a valley, no record company wanted us, management didn't want us, nothing.
The Bee Gees went through a hard stretch at a time when popular music was very transitional and people were looking for something new rather than the tried and true. The Bee Gees were having a very difficult time trying to figure out where to take their uniqueness, how to reinvent themselves, you know, and still stay distinctive.
The edge had gone a little. I didn't think they were paying the right attention to what was happening. I actually scrapped an entire album. I said, it's not worthy of you.
Kicking the head is worth taking the pants, yeah. Wonderful title.
I don't think it was a very good album. It was an awful album.
Oh, yeah. I mean, your ego's deflated enormously. You know, but that was meant to be, too. I mean, it wasn't good stuff.
The confrontation was painful because they put their hearts in it. They weren't being lazy. They were just a little bit off track.
In search of a more contemporary sound, their manager, Robert Stigwood, paired them with legendary R&B producer, Arif Mardin. Released in 1974, the Mr. Natural album did not crack the top 100. It was, however, an important transition as it reawakened their passion for soul music. During this difficult period, Barry and Robin became fathers for the first time. But Morris's marriage to Lulu was crumbling.
And when you spend 6 years of your life with somebody, it's like really weird all of a sudden you're driving around in your car with your bags in it and the dog on the front seat. You know, it's like very strange. So naturally, I turned to more drinking.
In late 1974, the Bee Gees began performing on the British nightclub circuit. One of the venues they played was Batley's Variety Club, where Morris met Yvonne Spenceley.
I just saw her eyes, and I said, I'm gonna marry her.
I think what came across more than anything was the warmth that he had. I thought, oh, what a really sweet guy he seems to be, you know? And I think that's what came across more than anything else, apart from him being talented, of course. I think that attracted me to him, and he was really cute.
Besides the innocence, I saw a lot of strength. She's very compassionate.
He's very romantic. Very sweet.
Oh, definitely, without question, the best thing I've ever done is marry Yvonne. Without a doubt.
As 1974 gave way to 1975, the Bee Gees were ready for a new beginning. Their old friend, Eric Clapton, then on the verge of a comeback of his own, suggested that the brothers try Miami's Criteria Studios. With Arif Mardin again producing, they started recording a new album.
We were on our way back from the studio, and every time you leap Criteria, there's a bridge, and the bridge is rickety, and it makes a noise when you go over it, and every night I'd hear the same thing. That ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch. And I'd hear it every night. And so one night we went over there and the car must have been traveling at a certain speed and the rhythm felt really right. And I just started singing along with it. And it just became, you know, I don't know where the term jive talking came from, that just sort of popped into my head. As is what usually happens if I have an idea for a song. It's not something I ask for, it just comes. And this was something, and I thought, wait, I gotta sing this tomorrow from Robin when I get home. I sang the idea to them, and we actually wrote the entire song that night.
Well, we played it to Arif, and he went, Do you know what jive talking means? And we said, well, yeah, it's, you know, you're dancing. He says, no. I'm putting on this Turkish accent, you see, because this is how he talks. And he says, no, it's a black expression for bullshitting. And we went, oh, really? Jive talking, you're telling me lies. But he gave us the groove, the tempo, everything.
When I first heard jive talking, I had no idea it was the Bee Gees.
Everybody went, who?
the Bee Gees, Broken Heart Bee Gees? Are you kidding? And that changed our whole career.
With Jive Talkin', the Bee Gees had scored their first number one record in 4 years. Nights on Broadway, the second hit single from the main course album, introduced a key ingredient to the Bee Gees' new sound.
We've just done most of the vocal tracks. And usually, you know, at the end, you know, you have some ad-libs or some kind of thing to take us away from the original melody and have some fun, you know. So Barry said, I'll have a go.
I went out there on my own, I experimented, and I started answering, like, blame it all, you know, blame it all. And they, yes, fine, this is just what we were looking for. Okay, let's do more of that. Blame it all, on the nights on Broadway, singing them love songs. It was a discovery. We've discovered another element of the group that we can use and use well if we really think about it, you know. It doesn't have to be something I was thinking, my God, where is this coming from? I can do this. And my whole life I didn't know I could do this. So at that point, because we were so excited about this, we started writing songs for this voice.
When we sing songs like, you know how easy it is to hurt me, Fanny be tender. It's Barry and Robin singing in unison. But it sounds like one guy. A bit more Robin, but a bit more Barry. Are you sure? Which one is it? But it's a sound of the two. Then the three of us go into harmony on the Fanny be tender. Fanny be tender. So that blend has been used quite a lot. And it's when we do the harmonies, we bank them underneath with doubles and falsettos on top, so you get the full richness of the harmony.
In 1975, with hits like Fanny Be Tender, the Bee Gees had made a startling comeback, in part due to the production work of Arif Martin. So the brothers were distressed to learn that, for contractual reasons, they would have to make the next album without him. But Martin told the Gibbs not to worry. They could do it on their own, and he was right. Seemingly overnight, the brothers' songwriting had evolved from orchestral pop to a blend of white soul, R&B, and dance music. Children of the World was an enormous success, and the single, You Should Be Dancing, rocketed to number one in the summer of 1976. Determined not to let the momentum slip away, the Bee Gees immediately began writing material for their new album. After a month of hard work, the brothers' creative flow was interrupted by a call from Robert Stigwood. He needed music for a little film he was producing.
We were getting songs ready for our new studio album, which would be the follow-up to Children of the World, and it was imperative that we got that right instead of just, you know, stopping now and doing a few songs for a movie. Unless, of course, we knew it was going to be a huge film, which was no guarantee, of course.
You know, he told us it was about this guy who works in a paint shop on the other side of the bridge in Brooklyn, you know, and he blows his wages every Saturday night at a club and wins a dance competition. We thought, nice one, Rob.
Those songs were actually written before the film was even mentioned to us. How Deep Is Your Love, If I Can't Have You, Night Fever, Staying Alive, More Than a Woman, all written before we'd seen the film.
And they played me some of the songs that they'd written for Saturday Night Fever. And I couldn't believe that they'd done this. I mean, the stuff was so good. It was fantastic. I thought it was written by somebody else. And I didn't tell them that. Saturday Night Fever score was unique in taking the best of really funky black music and together with very tuneful white music and melding the two things together in a style that was irresistible. Even old men like me would get on the floor and move because you just couldn't stop it.
Saturday Night Fever was released in December of 1977. Unexpectedly, Stigwood's little movie became a cultural phenomenon. The film grossed $350 million at the box office. And the Fever double album sold over 30 million copies worldwide. For the next 20 years, it remained the best-selling soundtrack album ever.
Well, with Saturday Night Fever, they became one of the biggest groups on the planet, but also people who really set a social agenda in terms of style, making very urban music that had a broad, broad social appeal.
To have that kind of success was very rare, and again, we knew it was something that probably only the Beatles had experienced.
Yeah, it's a bigger hurricane this time. Sustained winds of 180 mile an hour. You can't answer your own phone. People are climbing over your walls. And so it's different this time. It's far more chaotic.
Anything that has a tremendously huge impact on the charts and on people of such a scale is something that takes on a life of its own. And you're out of control of the whole thing.
You become less important than the parts.
Well, we didn't know we were defining the culture. We were just still Barry Morris and Robin, wondering what the hell's going on. I think How Deep Is Your Love was one of those songs that you saw. You got a vision from it. It wasn't something you just listened to and said, oh, that's a good song or whatever. It was more than that.
The Bee Gees had become so dominant that in March of 1978, records written and produced by the brothers Gibb occupied 5 of the top 10 spots on the Billboard Hot 100. No other songwriters can make that claim. In spite of the enormous success and impact of Saturday Night Fever, the soundtrack did not receive an Oscar nomination. This lack of acknowledgement by the film industry for their groundbreaking work was a disappointment. What happened next was a complete disaster. For 11 years, Robert Stigwood's managerial advice had been nearly flawless. So when he approached them with the idea of turning a classic Beatles album into a movie in which they would star, it was irresistible.
I think the worst mistake we ever made was probably Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
2 weeks into the film, I knew what it was. Robin and Morris and myself all went to Robert's house and said, please take us out of this film. Please take us out of this film.
Oh, yes, we pulled it out. We wanted out of this film. We said, this is going to kill us.
There's no reason to make the movie. There was no reason to involve the Bee Gees in it. There's no reason for the Bee Gees to cover the Beatles' music. It seemed a project done for Hollywood reasons rather than musical or artistic reasons.
Once their work on Sgt. Pepper's was completed, the Bee Gees returned to Miami to make their first album since Saturday Night Fever.
It's incredibly difficult to sustain success of that sort because no sooner have you got one number one, okay, that's great, everybody lauds you, but the pressure to create another one is twice as hard. And for them to achieve the run that they had is unique.
Working again with producing partners Carl Richardson and Albie Gallatin, and their longtime band, Dennis Byron, Blue Weaver, and Alan Kendall, the Bee Gees recorded Spirits Having Flown, which became the most successful album of their career, selling nearly 15 million copies.
The Bee Gees' music in a lot of ways is very, very spiritual. That there is somebody listening and watching and caring and paying attention. And though it's never been hit too hard in terms of the band's conscious emphasis of it, I think it's very meaningful in terms of their appeal.
Nobody gets too much heaven no more. It's much harder to come by. I'm waiting in line. Nobody gets too much love anymore. It's as high as a mountain and harder to climb.
If you were to say to me what was the finest piece of work, it would have to be Too Much Heaven. There's just no question in my mind. There's a certain spirituality in that song that I don't think I've heard in any other song. And at the same time, I can't tell you how it came about. But I think that's what songwriting is. It's really not knowing what you're doing. If you knew what you were doing, you wouldn't have written Too Much Heaven.
Released in November of 1978, Too Much Heaven became their fourth straight number one single. In an unprecedented act of charity, the Bee Gees donated all royalties from the song to UNICEF, and working with Robert Stigwood, encouraged other artists to do the same. To date, the collective efforts of everyone involved have raised over $10 million.
I think that a lot of the Bee Gees songs had a strong social conscience. It's not surprising that they would donate the rights to a huge hit to UNICEF. I think that the Bee Gees were always very mindful of what was going on in the wider world. The Bee Gees' music was meant to talk back to the world. Tragedy, you know, right out of the chute, was just an absolute mammoth hit around the planet. And the record itself, artistically, it's a superb record. And it's a spooky, interesting record, too.
We wrote Tragedy and Too Much Heaven in the same afternoon. And we wrote Shadow Dancing that night with Andy. That was quite a role. For at least a couple of months, we were constantly writing. And the stuff was, the material was quality, it was good stuff.
They used to write three songs a day. From two, they used to go in at two, write three great songs, and come out at five. It's almost like going to the office. So they were really on fire.
Tragedy went to number one, as did the follow-up, Love You Inside and Out. The Bee Gees had now written and produced six straight number one records. No other group has ever accomplished such a feat.
And once they'd done that, then I think even the dimmest rock critic realized that they actually had some ability and they were going to be around for a long time.
In June of 1979, the brothers embarked on their first concert tour since the outbreak of fever.
Oh, it was fantastic, the whole experience. Of course, I mean, I don't like things in a mania stage. I like consistent, respectable success, because then it's more manageable. But when things are, when they get to a point like fever had, it was kind of out of control a bit.
I mean, it was absolute craziness. And all the time we were sitting there writing, not thinking about the outside world, you know, we were sort of like in our own little world.
The thing about the Bee Gees that people in this, in the world don't know, which I always find terribly sad, is their terrific humour.
So we go, gotta get a message to you, 2, 3, 4, to love somebody.
But they're always up for a laugh, the boys. Anything, especially when we're on tour.
This is boring. I mean, the audience is not exciting as the last one.
It works in South Pacific.
And then tweeze that kind of monotony. And the humour really got them through a lot of the things, yeah.
He's back.
Nights on Broadway.
No. Out. Come on.
If they had not been singer-songwriters, they would have been wonderful comedians, the three of them.
How did you people get back here? Come on. Come on. Sorry.
Excuse me.
We'll be waiting.
Are you going to pass?
I'm sorry, you can't come in.
Get him out.
He can't come in here.
But to go on stage and see the audience, and because I love, that's the only way you can say thank you, really, is by going on stage live.
The emotional highlight of the Spirits tour came when Brother Andy joined them on stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, Brother Andy!
How wonderful. And he was at his height too. He'd made it as well. And so it was a wonderful feeling. Now those four brothers.
Andy Gibb had always wanted to be a Bee Gee. But because he was so much younger than his brothers, when he began his career in music, it was as a solo artist.
Andy was a chip off the old block. He was a young BG. And the first three songs that he released went to number one in America, which were extraordinary. He idolized Barry particularly.
I would say that we were as much like twins as Morris and Robin. And we were very much alike. We looked alike, we had the same birthmarks. The difference was is that I was taller than Andy. But the way we felt and the way we thought was almost identical.
In 1977, Barry had taken 19-year-old Andy into the studio and produced a string of enormously popular singles. Andy's success, coupled with their own, brought the brothers Gibb to new career heights.
It was the best thing you can hope for, all the brothers, you know, enjoying themselves and being successful and working together.
During the drum break, he actually said to me, "Can you believe this craziness? Can you believe it all?" And I thought, no. It's incredible, isn't it? And he said, "Man, I'll never forget this."
By the summer of 1979, the fruits of their fever labors had brought the Bee Gees 5 Grammys. The Spirits Having Flown album and tour were racking up big numbers. And their star was rising over Hollywood Boulevard. But resentment was simmering among rock fans toward the dance music that had dominated the airwaves and the culture. On July 13th, 1979, between games of a baseball doubleheader at Comiskey Park in Chicago, a local radio station staged a disco demolition promotion.
There had to be a backlash. And it wasn't just because it was a backlash towards us. We happened to have just been the target.
Oh, they were blacklisted from American radio.
Don't forget to tune in this weekend. We're having a Bee Gees free weekend. You know? Now, can you remember that ever being said by about any other artist? No. Quite unique.
That's scary stuff.
Where art meets commerce sometimes, commerce doesn't know when to quit. And exposure beyond a certain point really isn't great. It got to that point, particularly domestically with the Bee Gees, because in the United States it's such a social laboratory and we will take on everything. In other countries and other cultures, people pick and choose. We tend to sit down at the table like it's a Viking wedding and stay there until everything's gone. It didn't stop them from making both great records and in some cases absolutely incredible records. But the United States, big a market as it is, as diverse a culture as it needed a rest from the Bee Gees.
Even though the musical landscape was changing, the brothers Gibb refused to be silenced. If radio wouldn't play their records, then they would have to find a new voice.
And we got nothing to begin to know. Our love, we'll climb any mountain, big or small, we are. And we never let it end.
Working with one of the greatest female vocalists of the 20th century, Barry and his production team took songs written by the brothers and produced Guilty, which would become one of the most successful albums of Barbra Streisand's career.
I don't wanna hear you.
Following his Grammy-winning association with Streisand, Barry went on to produce a series of projects that would bring enormous success to other artists. Among them was Dionne Warwick, who had a top 10 hit with the brothers, Heartbreaker.
Why do you have to be a heartbreaker when I was being what you want me to be? Sudden, everything I ever wanted has passed me by.
We've always valued ourselves, again, not just as artists, but as songwriters also. And it was just as important for us to have an artist singing one of our songs and being on the radio as it was for ourselves.
Working with another pop icon, the brothers crafted a song for Diana Ross, which became a European number one.
All you gotta do is get in the middle of a chain reaction. You get a medal when you're lost in action. I wanna get your love already for the sweet sensation.
Displaying their versatility, the Bee Gees took an R&B song they had written for Diana Ross and transformed it into a number one smash for Kenny Rogers and Dolly Parton. Islands in the Stream became one of the biggest selling singles in country music history.
Islands in the stream, that is what we are. No one in between, how can we be wrong? Sail away with me to another world. We rely on each other's from one lover to another.
When Islands in the Stream hit number one, it meant that, along with the eight Bee Gees chart toppers made with his brothers, Barry had now produced a total of 14 number one records, more than any other British producer, except for the Beatles' mentor, Sir George Martin.
The distinctive sound of the Bee Gees, obviously, is the quality of their song. But also, Barry's high voice has something to do with it too, melding in with whatever singer he's working with, Streisand or whoever it is. That gives a unique sound, and there's no one else who does it. Simple as that.
Living eyes, when under the sun don't rise.
The brothers were busily creating hits for other artists, but their own recordings were not as successful. Neither 1981's Living Eyes album, nor Stayin' Alive, the sequel to Saturday Night Fever, produced a top 10 single.
You know, there were very turbulent times. 1980 was a pretty much a landmark year, because that's when my marriage to my first wife ended. And of course it was hard, because the children I have from that marriage are very young at the time. And I was always having to be away, I was working. I would prefer them to have been with me. But of course, they were going to school in England, and it was a very messy period.
After separating from Molly, Robin met artist Dwina Murphy. There was an instant connection.
We decided when we first met each other, we just knew that we were going to have a child together.
I already had two great kids, Spencer and Melissa, and I thought one more would round it off. You know, she just seemed the right person to want to have another child with.
He has a lovely kind of poetic way about him.
Come again. Use a talent.
He's very quiet about his talents and things. He has a little keyboard, and sometimes in the middle of the night, I'll wake up and I'll hear this beautiful sort of little chords playing, and then this lovely voice singing. It's like being awakened by angels or something.
After 3 years of hit-making, Andy Gibb fell victim to the same pressures and temptations of first fame that had overwhelmed his brothers.
I talked to him outside on the balcony, saying, you know, this is really a nice house, Andy. There's a nice car out there, that Porsche. Really nice. You're not going to keep all this, you know. He said, what do you mean? I said, you do what you're doing, this stuff will vanish. All this stuff will go. Your career will go out the window, everything. And he says, I know, I know. I know what I have to do.
But Andy couldn't be helped. Neither at this point in time could Morris, who was still not dealing with his drinking problem. He did, however, find joy in fatherhood.
He's always been real good with the kids. Even when he drank, he was there for the birth of both of them.
It's a miracle that no one can really ever get over when you see this. When you see your own flesh and blood, you know, coming to life. And then you give it that first squeeze of life and he starts wriggling and crying and wow, and I washed him down and he's my little boy. Now he's 24 and he still likes to sit on my lap.
He's a very good father, Morris. He's got two nice kids, they're all grown up now, of course. They all put the families first before anything.
If I didn't have children, I don't think I'd be the total person I am now. The most wonderful thing about having children is that you get to go on being a child. You get to grow up again. You get to live your childhood again through theirs.
Family has always been at the heart of the Bee Gees story. And over the years, that family has continued to grow. Barry has 5 children. Robin has 3. And Morris has 2. In 1986, following a series of solo projects, the brothers came to the realization that the industry was more interested in them as the Bee Gees than as individuals. After a 5-year break, they decided to come back together as a group. You Win Again was an enormous international hit, reaching number 1 in England, making them the first group ever to top the British charts in 3 straight decades. The Bee Gees had successfully launched their 3rd major comeback. But this achievement was not one they could cherish. On March 10th, 1988, only days after his 30th birthday, Andy Gibb, the Bee Gees' little brother, died from heart disease.
Maybe I don't want to know the reason why, but lately you don't talk to me, darling, I can't see me in your eye.
I had a dream once that die, and it scared the hell out of me.
And I remember the morning when I got the news. It will always burn in my brain and in my heart. He was a great kid.
I think it was hard on all of them and their wives. They all took it very hard. Every one of us, all of us, we all took it very hard.
To me, it was just shocking that a guy so young had to leave so early.
If once you lose someone of your own blood, I think it changes you radically. I think the spiritual lesson and the soul growth, I think is the term. Whatever they say, whatever the term is, I think you grow deeply inside and you never really forget.
The loneliest feeling I felt was when his coffin was left outside the thing, the wall, where they put the coffins inside the wall. And we were driving away and I looked at the wall and I just saw it. There was no one else there, just his coffin lying there against the wall. And I felt like he'd been abandoned. And we all wanted to go back and just stay with him because he was by himself with these strangers in green coats that are coming up, and it was so eerie.
Well, it makes you treasure everybody more. It's a kind of reminder of your mortality, isn't it?
So if there's anything to be learned is that nothing lasts at all.
The week after, we thought maybe if we go back to work, we can, you know, get
resented or something. And I was playing the strings, and it was very beautiful. Barry and Robin just started crying, and I just started crying. I said, I can't play anymore. We went home, and about a month later, we came back in, and then we did Wish You Were Here, Brandy. And that was difficult to sing, very difficult. But we wanted to sing it, we wanted to do it.
I lost everything in losing you.
The brothers poured their broken hearts into a new album, One. The title song was a worldwide success. The Bee Gees embarked on their first U.S. tour in a decade, followed by the album High Civilization, then a European tour. What the public didn't know was that Barry, the rock-solid older brother, was battling a serious back problem.
It was literally agony doing Europe, and after that I couldn't walk.
And when you sing falsetto, it's a hell of a high range to go to. You need your back, and it's agony when you do it, because you You know, you feel it before you've even taken half a breath. So Barry was going through all that stuff. I don't know how he did it, but he didn't want to do a bad show.
If you reach the point where you ask for back surgery, you're in trouble. And there was no recourse because, I was basically a cripple at that point if I didn't have back surgery.
Are you ready?
You guys ready?
In the early 90s, Barry wasn't the only brother living in constant pain. Morris's social drinking had turned into full-blown alcoholism. He was finding it more and more difficult to fulfill his responsibilities as a brother, a father, and a husband.
It really took a long time. You know, when it interferes with you as a family, then that's definitely when it's a problem.
For me, it's an ongoing battle. It's not, you don't really win. It's something, if I'm an alcoholic, I'm an alcoholic for the rest of my life. Since I've been in my recovery program, it's changed my life, my health, my wife, my kids, my career.
Through him being an alcoholic, believe it or not, we as a family are so much closer now and learned so much. We communicate much more. The kids can talk to me or Morris about anything, and that makes us feel good, you know. Especially the world that they live in, you know. I mean, this is not an easy life for kids to be brought up in.
I'm very proud of Morris because he's gone through an awful lot. It's just wonderful the way he's turned his whole life around.
Well, I'm in love with him more today than I was 27 years ago. And to have what we have now, and for him to have done what he's done, makes me and the children really proud of him.
Spouse, lover, friend, what was the last one?
Companion. No.
In 1992, to celebrate a year of sobriety, Morris and Yvonne renewed their wedding vows.
We always talked about it one day that we would do it, but this was the right time and the right moment and the right reason, and it was a beautiful day.
We have grown so much and learned so much about each other. I just feel very lucky, you know, that I have him actually in my life. And I never thought I would have said that 10 years ago. But that's true. I love him to death, you know.
In 1992, Hugh Gibb, the father of this close-knit clan, the man who had guided the Bee Gees' career in their early years, died.
Losing Andy was, he just like he died himself. And I think Dad really died of a broken heart more than anything. Because we felt more comfortable when Dad passed away because he was now with Andy. And obviously Andy needed him. So we felt more comfortable about that.
1992 was also the year Barry and Linda welcomed a new blessing, a baby girl, Allie. In the wake of the passings of Andy and Hugh, as well as the severe physical ailments that sidelined him, a little girl was just the tonic Barry needed.
It stops you from feeling sorry for yourself. You have problems, but so does everybody else. And then suddenly this little angel comes along. I came back to life in a way because of Allie, you know. She distracted me from feeling sorry for myself. And I gave all my energy to her and her mother. And once again, that's that. It's family, you know. You got to have that foundation before you have anything else, you know. For me.
In 1993, the Bee Gees made their 22nd studio album, Size Isn't Everything. Even though they had racked up every imaginable sales and chart achievement and produced a remarkable body of work, the respect of the music industry, particularly in America, had eluded them. That was about to change.
When your music or any creative endeavor starts to endure over a span of four decades, as the Bee Gees had by the 90s, then you're starting to be relevant for a lifetime. And that's a very, very difficult thing to do. I think the only way you can do it is to be truly singular and original.
I stumble in the night, never really knew what it would have been like. You're no longer there to break. And the turbulent years when I would not wait for no one. And stop, take a look at myself. See me losing you.
Size Isn't Everything was one of their strongest post-Fever albums, featuring UK top 40 hits Paying the Price of Love and the epic ballad For Whom the Bell Tolls. The Bee Gees were inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame in 1994. 2 years later, as they prepared to celebrate the 30th anniversary of their first international hit, the unexpected happened. The music industry and the media began to reevaluate the Bee Gees' place in rock history.
It's a colossal honor for me to present this award to a group who've been going for 30 years. To put that in perspective, our newcomers here tonight will have to keep going to the year 2027 to equal the achievements of the brothers Gibb.
Having the word British stamped on it is, we always wanted to be recognized by the country we were born in. And to have that is wonderful.
The attention that the Bee Gees got in the late 90s was really, really long overdue.
Robert Stigwood, as the greatest showman in the world, if you don't accept this award alongside us tonight, then we will not accept it either.
But I was so proud of my lads, so I thought it was an overdue recognition for them.
After they got the award, Lifetime Achievement, they then did a set of 7 or 8 of their biggest hits in front of a huge industry audience. But it wasn't just the people in the industry, it was kids. I mean, I took my own kids who were, at that point, 19, 21. And what amazed me was that how my children and their friends of the same age group, they knew all the songs. And the place went bananas. Because the youngsters had no preconceived thoughts about the Bee Gees other than their great songs. They've come back so often, they haven't been away, but if it could be said that they had a critical comeback, it was that night, I think, that kicked it into motion. And the industry had finally realized that they were world beaters up there with the best.
Please stand and welcome Barry Robin Morse Gibb, the Bee Gees.
I don't think I've ever seen the Bee Gees as emotional or as proud as when they heard that they were being elected into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
But not only getting inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but being inducted by Brian Wilson, to me, was a knockout. That blew my night.
We should be speechless, but we're not.
With all the Grammys and all the American Music Awards and all the Brit Awards, the idea of being in a small group of great artists was overwhelming to them.
Tonight, I think we've come home, and we thank you very much for this honor.
It is the ultimate honor. Anyone, any rock singer or pop singer who doesn't want to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is insane. It's the dream of a lifetime.
Almost without their knowing, these characters become legends, icons. And this is absolutely fitting. The Bee Gees are in that state now. And if they're not careful, they go on being even more famous than they are already.
The Bee Gees were grateful for the recognition, but they weren't looking back. The brothers were determined to create new music that would prove they were still a vital force. Unfortunately, Barry's ongoing physical problems meant the Bee Gees couldn't tour as planned. His back surgery triggered an arthritic condition, and for Barry, who had been an avid tennis player in the 70s and 80s, there were days where he could barely strum a guitar. And then, to make matters worse, he had a heart scare.
I must have gone through 50 different tests and about four different doctors. It was really, it was a depressing situation, and they said, "Yeah, your heart is contracting one way, but when it's coming, it's not really doing it the right way. However, it's common, and it's not life threatening. But that's the reason why you're having the dizzy spells, and that's the reason why you're tired, you know." So I got past that, but there was no way I was going to go on the road. No way.
Even with the Bee Gees on the sidelines, their music remained in the forefront. Contemporary artists rediscovered the Bee Gees as songwriters.
So this is who I am, and this is all I know. And I wish just to live for all that I can give, the spark that makes the power grow.
It all stems from Robert Stigwood asking us for one more song for the show Saturday Night Fever. And at the same time, Tommy Mottola called up and asked if we had a song for Celine. And we said, well, we just happen to have this song that we've done for Fever, the musical, and we'll send that to her and see if she likes it. And the next thing I know, she calls me up and she says, I love this song, I'm going to do it. We were thrilled.
We don't say.
Barry's physical problems made it impossible for the Bee Gees to mount a major tour. So they invented a new way of bringing their music to millions of fans around the world.
The idea was to try to create an event that allowed the Bee Gees to perform in a way that everyone who wanted to see them could. And we came up with a concept called One Night Only. And for one night, anyone in the country could come see the Bee Gees or see it on television.
Right now, we feel more comfortable doing just special event shows, almost like the three tenors do, you know? But there's three of us anyway, and we can sing pretty high.
Nobody gets too much heaven no more. It's much harder to come back. I'm waiting in line.
Over the next 2 years, the Bee Gees took One Night Only around the world, performing one concert on each continent to standing room only crowds. It became a pay-per-view event, a television special, and a CD that sold over 5 million copies.
It was like a mission, you know? You go in, you hit hard, and you go home. I'm almost certain that we will tour again in a more traditional fashion, but this was fun.
We were in England, we were doing Wembley Stadium. We'd see all these thousands of people coming into the stadium, you know, and it holds like 70,000 people. And it was just for us, it was, wow. And we actually came off stage and Barry said, I think we got away with it again. They have no idea we've got no talent at all. We've got away with it again.
We hope you like this one, and we think you'll remember it.
Are we ready? That's the one you're going to use.
That's the one. Yeah, all
right. The Bee Gees made a triumphant return to Australia in 1999 with One Night Only.
Where is the sun that shone on my hair? The sun in my life, it is dead, it is dead.
Going back to Sydney for the Olympic Stadium, it was kind of weird feeling in a way, because compared to when we first left Australia, where we lived in Sydney, of course, that place wasn't even built, but it was a kind of novel experience to be there and to remember being struggling when we were there the last time. And then suddenly, you know, you're in front of 64,000 people.
The spicks and the specks of my life gone away, everybody. Spicks and specks. Spicks and
in the year 2000, the Bee Gees went to work on a new album. Once again reinventing their sound, they gave a contemporary twist to their musical roots.
I've seen this story, I read it over once or twice. I said that you say a little bit of bad advice. I've been in trouble, happened to me all my life. I lie and you lie, and who would get the sharpest knife?
You know it shouldn't be somebody like that, but the kind of man to throw his hand into the ring and go down without following through. The day turns into night.
This is where I came in. I guess it's our way of saying that nothing ever really changes. It's very honest, and it reflects our feelings about everything that's happened to us in the past 30 years. This is
just where I came in. We wanted that live feel, particularly on the opening track, and we just wanted to rock a bit more. But This Is Where I Came In is the harmony thing. We just wanted us, the three of us around one mic, singing the harmony on this song.
This is kind of a lot of elements what we're doing on the new album that we used to do a long time ago. There's an old kind of ingredients to it that we used to do, and it's kind of like come full circle.
It's real instruments, real voices, real musicians, and it's great lyrics and melodies that I think is gonna catch people emotionally in a way that music used to. This is just where I came in.
This is where I came in. They don't know what they do. Forgive them all their sins. They know they cannot take away what you have given me.
The success of the Bee Gees is unparalleled. A 5-decade-long career. Well over 100 million records sold worldwide. And with nearly 1,000 compositions to their credit, the brothers Gibb are one of the most successful songwriting teams ever. Hundreds of artists have recorded their songs, and everybody has a favorite.
My all-time favorite Bee Gees songs.
Oh my God.
I mean, which do you pick out of all that lot, you know?
Absolutely impossible question.
I would say New York Mining Disaster.
Nights on Broadway is a great song.
I Started a Joke.
Do You Win Again?
Tragedy.
Family Pretender.
Gotta Get a Message to You.
This is not fair to so many songs.
Staying Alive.
They have to be the Saturday Night Fever song.
Jive Talking.
How Deep Is Your Love?
How Deep Is Your Love?
I mean, I love Too Much Heaven.
Too Much Heaven.
Of course, I love to love somebody because it was my birthday present.
Words.
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 Can't say I have a favorite Bee Gees song.
For Whom the Bell Tolls.
Won't do it.
I mean, Holiday. I mean, I can go on and on, you know. And say they like our kids. It's difficult to single one out and say, that's my favorite.
This is the danger zone. This is where I came in. They don't know what they do. Forgive them all their sins. They know they cannot take away what you have given me.
I love all the stuff that they've done already, but I'm always looking forward to the next one that's going to come out.
Undoubtedly, the Bee Gees will be looked back upon as being a very important part of the 20th century. Unique in respect of their musical contribution in writing, performing, and producing. They were, and still are, an incredible group.
The body of work is so gigantic. It literally is gigantic. I mean, hundreds upon hundreds of really strong songs that are in the popular idiom, and you're never going to get them out, so it's too late. It's like you better surrender because you've been invaded already. You know, like the battle is won, the conquest is over.
Having had such a remarkable career, what's left for the brothers Gibb to accomplish?
Brain surgery, which brings in an extra few dollars on the weekend.
Just a lot of few things, a lot more new adventures out there we haven't even touched yet.
An artist will always think they've got something to prove, and I think that's what keeps them going.
You're always proving yourself, and I think we will go on doing that until there's simply no more left to do. We've never had the opportunity to be nominated for an Academy Award. It's one of our dreams.
I'm proud that they're where they are today, and they're still normal, fairly well-adjusted young men, middle-aged men. I shouldn't say that, should I? They'll kill me.
And at this point in my life, I'm real content with all of it. And I think the Bee Gees, whatever they are, will be remembered. And I'm happy about that. You know, some people last 5 years. We've lasted 40 years.
I think one's most impressed by the fact that they have kept going. I mean, it's true, when you do ask me to name somebody who's still writing, great songs in this field. There aren't very many, and you think, it's extraordinary. Most people either lose their talent or get fed up. And they seem to have done neither. It's taken that long for the slowest members of the musical society, i.e. the critics, it's taken them that long to realize how good they are. The public knew that forever. But even they now realize, as we have realized for many, many years, that the Bee Gees deserve to be up there as songwriters with Dylan, Lennon McCartney, Pete Townsend, Ray Davies, Elton. Bee Gees are as good as that lot.
When everyone starts saying, you know, but we really like the Bee Gees, you know. And I'm saying, what? You can't. It's not... No, you didn't like us before. You're not allowed to like us now. No. I think the downs through our career have given us the strength and anger and, you know what I mean, to overcome what people say that aren't good, to confound the critics, you know. So my mission is to confound the critics.
To me, we're the Still Three Kids from Manchester who wanted to be famous and just wanted to make music. We didn't know how much you earned. We didn't know what it cost to buy a guitar or an amplifier or a microphone even have a roadie. We never thought of that stuff. To us, it was a magical world that we wanted to be a part of, you know? So it was just something that I'm still that kid. I don't see ourselves as legends.
I think the secret of what we feel is that we never lost the enthusiasm for what we do when we were little kids. It's still there, the sense of wonder. And sometimes you get a little bit phased and a little bit tired. But then, you know, you wake up one morning and you say, let's go back in the studio.
We may never see a Bee Gees again. We never see a band prevail in every popular sense across five decades.
No, they never give up and they never will.
I think the Bee Gees will always be there.
So I don't think we could just stop being what we've done for so many years. As I think as long as we have an audience, yeah.
I can see them in wheelchairs, still recording and writing.
Barry always says he'll finish up in a home in a wheelchair, and the boys will go and see him, and the nurse will say to them, he's so happy today. They played one of his songs on the radio, and his little eyes lit up.
I'm not sure you want old Bee Gees. But I hope and pray that the music lasts, you know, because to me that's immortality. That's immortality. Supreme human being in his own right. Legend in his own time. Great man, great legs, good walker.
Rubbish.
Some strange people around here. Actually, we used to sleep together when we were kids, when we used to all live at home together. It was only last week, actually.
We had to cut back a bit because my dad was a gambler.
Bloody lies, isn't it? Something's going on. And yes, here it is. This is our mother. How are you, mother?
Not bad, son.
I've heard three or four tracks of the album, which is fantastic.
There you go, mate.
Thank you very much.
Looking for a hole.
I found an escape hatch, gentlemen. You can get away. Quick, this way.
This is where we go out.
This is where we leave.
Thanks, guys.